time now for Louisville's number one urban sports talk radio show, the 3-5 KY Sports Show, right here on 93.9 The Ville. Now, here's your host, Jeff Lightsey Jr.
And welcome in, everybody. My name is Jeff Lightsey Jr. You're listening to the 3-5 KY Sports Show right here on 93.9 The Ville. We're getting right into it. We got a special guest in the building. I call him Coach Green because he was my coach way back with the Fly J Rams. And now he's coaching the young men over at Central High School. But most of you guys know him as Abin Green. How's it doing, Coach Green?
Man, it's going great, man. It's living the dream, it feels like, man. So just glad to be up. Dealing with some football this morning and having some fun, man.
Yes, I'm happy to be here. Yes, sir. Yes, they're dealing with the football because they are in the playoffs, third round, Central High School, moving on. They'll play Cal next week because we saw some people go home. But we'll get into the high school thing and everything that you got going on. But, Coach Green, I want to just ask you, man, just you were inducted to the University of Louisville Hall of Fame recently. And you had your family up there with you. Just, I want to get right into it. What was that like to go into the U of L Hall of Fame?
Oh, man, it still feels like a dream. I was able to bring a lot of my family in. I had a bunch of tables. We had about 10, maybe 10 tables.
Oh, my goodness.
Loaded it up, man. A bunch of my friends surprised me and actually showed up and bought tickets, and they came out to support. We had a great weekend. Some of my frat brothers, they got the club downtown for me, and we had it both days. And we just celebrated and blew it up, man. But it still feels like a dream, man. It's a dream come true. I'm thankful and humble, but I'm still floating.
Man, it is one thing to, like you said, be an alumni, you know, put your blood, sweat, and tears into an organization. Then it's another thing to get recognized at that level. Well, let's talk about the lead up to the Hall of Fame, because they don't just put everybody in the Hall of Fame. You know what I mean? You had to do something. Take me all the way back to your playing days. Let's call it at Male High School. Or first, let me ask you, when did you realize, like, I'm a pretty good athlete? What was it, age 5, 10, 15? Like, what age was it that you realized, like, man, I can actually do something with this football thing?
Man, it's just funny. I hated football. I was a basketball player. I love basketball, you know, because for one, you know, with the elements. You know, it's cold. Rainy, you know, you got to hit somebody. You got to put on a helmet and run into somebody all for 40 minutes. But going to, in Male High School, playing with Coach Redmond, he came in and he told me, he said, you play basketball, you're 6'2", and your coach plays you at center. Name me a 6'2" center in college. Well, Coach, I just love basketball. And he was like, well, come play for me, and I'll make sure your mom doesn't have to pay for school. So when he said that, I was like, oh, well, say less. I definitely want to go to college. And then after that, man, it seemed like to go up. I played in middle school with Chris Redmond, his son, and we had a great friendship, brotherhood. But I never in my life would I look it back and say, oh, I'm going to be a Hall of Famer one day. So it started at Male High School, earned a scholarship, and then going into U of L and the success, it was just – It was just a godsend, man. Everything seemed to flow. Everything seemed to fit in spite of myself because, you know, being a kid coming in, just giving too much is given, much is required. I played around with it a little bit. I enjoyed it, but I'm blessed to reap some of the benefits of some of the success that we had on the field.
And that's amazing to hear you talk about, like, man, I was a hooper. Like, I wanted to hoop. They played me a center at 6'2". When you're talking about the Redmonds, you played with Chris in middle school. Obviously, you guys just set records in high school. During your time, though, because Chris Redmond was, like, you know, high school player of the year, and he was throwing it to somebody. You know what I mean? He wasn't catching the passes. Right. He was throwing a lot of them to you. Tell me about the recruiting process. You said Coach Redmond told me you wouldn't have to pay for school. Chris Redmond obviously went to – I don't know what his recruiting process was, but what was it like for you? Did you know you wanted to stay with Chris? Did you have some of the similar offers, or was U of L always the school? Like, how did that kind of work for you?
I had a ton of offers back then. We was visiting – I mean, yeah, I think coming out of Male High School, we had some great athletes coming too. One of my good friends, Tony Driver, was coming out, and me and him hung. But we went to visit a lot of places. We went to Florida State, Michigan. Went and visited a lot of places. But back then – I wanted to play receiver, and a lot of schools weren't passing the ball. U of L was one of the passing teams, and also Boston College. I narrowed it down, and Kentucky was in the mix. But Kentucky was in the mix because Tim Couch had committed. Yes. He committed early, so I knew they were going to have a quarterback. Chris was going to Illinois. He was wanted to go to Illinois and then Oklahoma. I wasn't going to Oklahoma. I wanted to go to Illinois, but that didn't work out. I wasn't going to Oklahoma. So I went on to sign with Louisville. And then Chris called me like about a week or so later and said he was coming to Louisville. So it was just more of a fit. And then also my mom. I didn't want my mom to have to travel a million miles to see me play every week. I was used to her being in the stands and everything else. So U of L was a great fit. I'm a diehard Louisville fan, grew up like that. So it was almost a no-brainer. Just come here and I was going to pay for my school and I was going to enjoy some time with them and it worked out.
And what was just tell me about, like, because, like I said, you're in the Hall of Fame. So it means you did something. We talked about you earned those offers in high school, but that means you and Redmond was putting in work at U of L. What was that like, that experience to play with your high school quarterback, who you guys were able to set records with, and then come to college and pretty much light it up there? Maybe not from the beginning, because you're telling me about their freshman year, but to do what you guys were able to do.
We put up big numbers my freshman year. Even though we were losing, we were still putting up big numbers. We were all young. We were all freshmen. So we put up big numbers. But it was just me and him had a chemistry. We've been having a chemistry since we were in a little league playing back in the days of JCTMS, going in the mail. And we can just give each other that look, and we just know, hey, he'll tell me, hey, man, get open, and because I'm coming to you. So over the years, just practicing together, knowing each other, knowing how we run routes, knowing how he passes, he can put the touch on it, whether he can throw it. I used to tell him all the time, man, just throw it to the end zone. I'm going to go get it. So, Chris, man, he great quarterback. I was fortunate enough to have a great quarterback coming up like that, man. It's almost like my own quarterback. He had his own receiver. So, just that success of the repetitions that we were able to do over the years definitely panned out.
Absolutely. Once again, we're talking to Iben Green, University of Louisville Hall of Famer now, and also my former coach at Little League. Now, Coach Green, we got to talk about the coaching aspect. When did you realize that you wanted to get in coaching? Were you playing knowing, like, hey, when this is done, I want to, you know, give back and coach? Or how did the coaching thing come about?
I love teaching. I love teaching the technique of it all, because a lot of it is using your mind, your brain, and learning the techniques of it all. But I had five kids, five daughters, and three of them were athletes. Mm-hmm. So I did a lot of their personal training, but also did a lot of their transportation. I was like dad Uber. So I was taking them to tournaments, taking them to workouts, and taking them to different things, because I wanted them to be able to use their athleticism and their success in athletics to boost their careers and boost their lives to where you can get paid for doing something that you really, truly love, which is, I got two basketball players and a volleyball player. Mm-hmm. So at the end of it all, my last kid, Mariah, she 19 now, she freshman at Central High School. So I'm over there, and I'm 100% dad. So I'm at every game. I'm doing the bake sales. I'm doing the concession stand. And I end up volunteering to be an assistant athletic director. And I got to meet Coach Dantzler over there, the head coach, football coach. And we talked. I love him. Guy's a great guy. Love coaching with him and different things. And the relationship really, really clicked to the point of where I definitely could go over there. And I knew I could be a help. Mm-hmm. And I've been over there ever since. It's been about, this is my fifth year. Fifth year. Yeah. Some of those years. Yeah. But and I love it. I love, I'm able to teach. I'm able to help some guys just benefit and go do some of the similar things I did. Get a scholarship, get your school paid for, and change your life. Change your lives. My football's changed my life. So I just want to help my teammates, my players, and my coaches just use the sport of football to change their lives and to change their families' lives.
Absolutely. That is awesome. And that is your coaching at the high school capacity. But like I said, you coached me at Little League. When you were coaching us, I didn't know you was this good at football. Like, I mean, we had heard that you could play ball a little bit, but what made you decide at that time? I mean, we're talking, I mean, I ain't trying, but yeah, how old you are, but you know, we're talking a long time ago. When I was in Little League, what made you decide to volunteer your time away from your family? You talk about having those five daughters to come help out dudes over in West Louisville at Fly J Park, learn the game.
But the irony of it all is that it's always been about my kids. Mm-hmm. It's always been about my family. My kids were cheerleading for the Rams. So I had to be at practice. So I would go sit. I had to drop them off and pick them up. So I would go sit. And I knew some of the guys, and some of the guys would recognize me. And like, hey, man, you need to come over and help out. You need to come help out. So that's how I got pulled into that part of it. with all the coaches over there asking me to come help out. And I built a relationship with them guys, and we had a ton of success. You guys were athletic. You guys were not only were y'all athletic, y'all were smart, man. It was just fun teaching y'all because y'all would grasp onto the concepts. We can show y'all little tricks, and we can show y'all little techniques that will help you be successful. And that's really what I love doing about coaching, especially in the West End.
Yes, it was awesome, man. It was awesome to be a part of. It was awesome to have you on the sideline and then to get older and be like, man, we didn't know we had Ivan Green as our coach. Like, we had this Hall of Famer this whole time. Like, we should have been listening a little more. We might have won even more games than we did back then.
Man, that's funny because kids won't lie to you. So, you know, you run into a kid, a 5-year-old kid, and he tells you your breath stinks. He's like, man, hold on, man. They won't lie to you. They'll tell you the truth, but they also are like sponges. And they soak it up, and they listen. They soak it up, and they listen. Once you build the relationship with them, and they know that you're not full of mess. They know that you're genuine and you really, really, truly care about them and want them to be successful. So that's what I loved about it. And I loved about coaching you guys. You guys were sponges, man. And y'all look back on it. I'm humble enough to say, no, I'm a Hall of Famer now.
Yeah.
But nah, man, it wasn't about that part. It was about using the sport of football to change my life and to create athletes that can use it to change their lives too. So I never looked at it as being in Hall of Fame and bragging. I just looked at it as I'm helping out some kids.
Yeah. Hey, you did. You did. We had a ton of fun, a ton of success. Now, you talk about your coaching over at Central. You brought up, you know, Coach Redmond, who now over, well, he's Chris Redmond, but he's the coach over at Cal now. Just how far do you want to take the coaching thing? Are you good being an assistant? Do you maybe one day want to be a head coach of a high school team, maybe on a college staff? Like, or is this you just like what you're doing and just going with the flow?
At the moment, I like what I'm doing and I'm going with the flow. Mm-hmm. Some rumors have been floated out to some different moves that can possibly be made here and there on the high school and the college level. But right now, man, I'm happy. I'm an empty nester.
Yeah.
All my kids are in college or gone. I got one coaching D1 basketball down in Florida, so I'm able to travel and go see mm-hmm. them, spend some time. I got 3 grandkids. I'm able to feed them chocolate ice cream every morning for breakfast. So just trying to enjoy that part of it. College coaching and coaching period is time consuming.
Yeah.
It's very, very time consuming. So it's something to think about. But if I get an offer that I can't refuse or it's impossible for me to refuse, I definitely will take advantage of it. Because, I mean, it's football. And football has given me so much in my life. I would love to give back and to do something on that aspect. So it's up in the air. I'm not going to say no. But right now I'm just enjoying teaching and showing technique and giving guys opportunity.
That's awesome to hear, Coach Green. Now, once again, we're talking about Ivan Green, University of Louisville Athletics Hall of Famer. Now, you talked about having, you know, the grandkids, being an empty nester. Just what is it like now for you to look back and, you know, at the accomplishments that you were able to do as an athlete and as a man, and then to sit back with your grandkids now and you know, tell them about what, you know, granddad was able to do, or now what they see when they see you get inducted to things like Hall of Fame. What is that like for you and your family?
I mean, it gives me chills. I'm able to take pictures that they're up on the stage with me. They were my grandkids at the banquet, and it's something that you can't write. It's a storybook. Mm-hmm. Like, you, nobody sits back at a young age and says, man, I'm going to be in the Hall of Fame one day. That's my goal, is to do this, to do that. We want to win games, win championships, you know, make big plays. But at the end of it all, to be in the Hall of Fame is unreal. It's like a dream, man, to be up there with the Lamar Jacksons, the John Unitases, and Tyrese McClouds, Roman Oban. It's so many, Chris Redmond. It's just so many different players. That's for life. So, like, for me, that's more for my family and my mom. That's my mom's legacy. I spoke on that at the banquet
mm-hmm.
and just told my mom, I said, look around, this is your legacy. I said, you created this. You did this. So well done. So that part of it, just having my family experience that and them being able to benefit from it, from the game to the red carpet rolled out. And everybody was had a great time. They were entertained. And that was the big thing about it, man. It was all for them. I was playing for my family. And now we're reaping the benefits of all the seeds that we've sown.
Absolutely. Now, from one Hall of Famer to another one, Coach Jeff Brohm is coaching this year's team. Just what are your thoughts on what he's been able to do this year and the success of the team this year?
Man, Jeff's always been an amazing guy, amazing friend, man. I love Jeff. I played for Jeff one time. When he came and coached for the Louisville Fire. Mm-hmm. I jumped on the team with him for a little while. So I've been knowing Jeff for a while, and the success he's having is major. Satterfield was great as a friend of mine as well. My only concern back then was the recruiting part of it. And mm-hmm. I think Jeff has a tab on that recruiting. He's going to be able to fill some of these spots, some of the gaps that we need. And he's just doing a phenomenal job. He's a great offensive-minded coach. He's got a lot of great people around him, brought back some of the locals, mm-hmm. Brian. And so I just think that his success is going to continue. And he's going to do some major things. I hate that we lost that Pitt game. We're going to drop that Pitt game. We've been a pretty cushy position right now. But I think Jeff's going to do great things, and I'm looking for sky's the limit for Jeff.
Absolutely. And Coach Green, I'll get you out of here on this. Just for the people at home that want to that's keeping up with you, what is next? Like, are there any things that you have on the horizon, or are you just kind of, you know, all systems go with what you got going on right now? But what is next for Ivan Green?
I'm just floating real, man. I'm just enjoying life, taking it as it comes, man. Fortunately, with football, I was able to get my degree as well. So I have my master's degree also. So I'm currently an administrator at JCPS. Mm. And I got 6 years till I can retire with that.
Okay.
So I'm just really riding that out, man. I got a great team. I'm over at the Minor Dames Academy. Mm-hmm. I got a great administrative squad. And we just raising kids and teaching kids every day. So right now, that's the part of it, just trying to settle into the empty nest syndrome and the administrator, and just take advantage of some of the opportunities. I was able to catch the game, go catch some of the games, the football games, and just really sit back and enjoy life and enjoy all of the things the seeds that I've sown. So that's really, I'm just going with the flow right now. Absolutely. Now, when something comes up, I'll definitely take advantage of it, but I'm in a great position. I'm blessed. God has blessed me, so I'm just enjoying life right now.
Absolutely. That is Ivan Green, or as I better know him as Coach Green. This is the 3-5 KY Sports Show. Coach Green, I appreciate you coming through, man. Thank you so much.
Man, I appreciate you having me, man. You're doing a great job, man. It just tickles me to death just to see you doing, you know, behind the microphone. And I told Coach Rob. You know, Coach Rob.
Yeah.
I told Coach Rob I just left him. He's doing the weightlifting over at Central. And I told him I was coming over and doing an interview with you, man. So he told me to tell you what's up. So, man, it's just great. I appreciate the opportunity. I would love to come back anytime you need. Just hit me up, man, and I'll come out.
Definitely. Hey, we're going to hold you to that.
I got you.
We're going to hold you to that. That is Ivan Green. You're listening to 3-5 KY Sports Show. We'll be right back after the break. And welcome back, welcome back, welcome back, everybody, to the 3-5 KY Sports Show. Thank you to Coach Ivan Green for stepping in for the first segment here on the show. And, you know, he took us away from what is going on right now. And I ain't talking about on the football, because we got to talk about football, because it's a feel-good story over on the gridiron, what's taking place at L&N Cardinal Stadium, what took place against Virginia this week, how we just miraculously came back. But I cannot ignore what I saw last night, and I cannot ignore the fact that that's the freshest thing on my brain. I almost forgot we had Coach Green coming in today because of what took place in the KFC Yum Center last night. And if you didn't know, also, if you want to get in here, 3831-939 is the text line, 502-3831-939, 8150-939 is the call in. If you have anything you want to get off your chest, and you'll come right after me, 8150-939 is the call in number. Now, I was watching the game. So before a game, I'm going to give you a little context of what happens in my life. So before a game, a lot of people hit me up for betting advice. Now, a lot of folks on these here airwaves do a lot of betting. I do a little betting, you know what I mean? A little pocket change made here and there. I feel like I know a few takes, so I put them out there. And one of my buddies from high school, shout out to Reggie. Reggie hit me up and said, hey, man, he's a North Carolina fan. Said, hey, man, you know, I'm putting together my ticket, putting together my parlay. They're giving Louisville, they're at home against Chattanooga. Come on, dog. Like, come on. Of course they can win that one, right? I said, before a game, I would never gamble for Louisville. I would never put any money on Louisville ever. Basketball ever. I had to tell him straight up. I was like, man, I'd be a bad friend if I told you to put any kind of money. If anything, take the points with Chattanooga. But they only gave him 4 points. But I said, take the points for Chattanooga. If you're going to put anything when it comes to Louisville basketball. And he said, all right, I'll just leave him off my ticket. And boy, I'm glad he did. Because at one point, we were down to UT Chattanooga with a coach that came from VMI. Where is VMI? I have no idea. I can't even tell you where VMI is at. I can barely locate Chattanooga on the map. And somehow, some way, we were down 20 points at one point and lost this game in points. Okay. Because I kind of got all that out. It's not working. Point blank, period. It's not working. See, I have in my notes right now is a word called foreshadow. You know, foreshadowing. Foreshadow is what I wrote down. And the definition of foreshadow, because I had that pulled up. The definition says, be a warning or indication of a future event. Be a warning or indication of a future event. See, last year we had foreshadowing to the season, whether we wanted to believe it or not. When we watched this team go out there and lose to Lenoir Rhyne, a Division II school, albeit exhibition, that was foreshadowing to the season. The season of hell. That was 4-28. And it just point blank period is what it was. And so nobody could have expected us to go 4-28 last year, and it is what it is. At the same time, I took the warnings this time. When we lost to Kentucky Wesleyan, another Division II school at home, albeit 1 point, 10 points, it don't matter, you lost. I took the warnings. I knew what was coming because I wasn't getting tricked this time. I wasn't sticking my neck out. I wasn't putting the cape on. I wasn't doing none of that this time. And I went on my Twitter page and I said, this probably won't last until January. This probably is going to end ugly, period. I saw it. I said, you're not fooling me this time. I'm not taking up for stuff that I normally wouldn't take up for. Like, I was doing it. I was being a hypocrite. I come on these here airwaves, and I talk about coaches, mainly coaches. I don't really talk a whole bunch about players collegially because I try not to. But I talk about coaches that aren't doing a good job, and I give them hell for not doing a good job. But this coach, I said, hey, you know, give him some time, man. Come on, man. Give him some time, you know, man. Power to the people. You know what I'm saying? I was all of that. And then a Kentucky Wesleyan game happened, and I jumped off ship. I did a complete 180. I'm flipping in this chair right now. I did it. I said, nah, man, fool me once, shame. Can't get fooled again. And I said, this ain't going to work. This ain't going to work. And then UMBC happened, and some people got encouraged by UMBC. See, me? No. Because I'm more of an eye test person versus analytics. There's people that fall in two categories. You have the eye test people that look at a game or look at a sport and say, hey, that doesn't look like that's going to work. And then there's people that use the stats and the analytics. See, I'm more the eye test. I can look at something and be like, something about that don't look right. You know, something about that, I don't know, man. I seen what stuff look like when it looks good, and that ain't it. I know what it looks like when you have a competent and a good basketball. I know what it looks like. I've seen it too many times. And not just here, but specifically here. I've seen it a ton of times here. But I can see across the country, you know, people laugh at what they do down in Lexington. I can look at that and be like, that'll work. Whatever they have, and I'll take two of those. You know what I mean? You ever been to a restaurant and you look at somebody else plate and be like, dang, that look good. Let me get that over there. Are you looking at somebody else's drink? I'm like, I don't know what drink I want, but I like his over there. Let me get that. And then they bring yours out and you ain't even got to taste it. You look at, I don't know. That ain't what the picture looked like. That ain't what I signed up for. See, I signed up for the picture. And see, the picture that was Kenny Payne was Bam Adebayo, was Anthony Davis, was Malik Monk, was De'Aaron Fox, was the big man whisperer. See, that was the picture. But see, the picture ain't always the product. See, sometimes you get what's in the picture, and then you taste the picture, and it tastes like the picture, meaning the box, the cardboard that the picture's on. See, it tastes like that. See, that's what's happening right now. We're tasting a whole lot of cardboard because it was pretty packaging. And this just ain't work. Nolan Smith, he comes from Duke. See, those are Zions and RJ Barrett. See, I wanted that. That's not what happened. And that's not what's happening. Sometimes some guys are built for to be assistants. Sometimes guys are built to be head coaches. and that's just what it is. I mean, I'm gonna just be honest with you. That's just what it is. It looks like our coach is better off as an assistant. See, and I was always hesitant to say something like that because I was scared of the backlash that could happen of saying something like that. Because I remember someone said that about Charlie Strong. I'll hold on to that because we got Lawrence on the line. Lawrence, talk to me, Lawrence. What's on your mind?
What's up, Jeff, man?
Talk to me. What's happening?
And you heard me over the years, and today I have always been a loyal fan to his basketball program, to any coach. But after last night, this man got to go.
It's Lawrence, y'all. It's Lawrence saying that. Keep going. My bad.
He got to go because that last night was – I don't like seeing that. I don't like seeing my team look that bad, out of play, not playing hard, not playing any type of defense. Because if Coach Pete was still head coach here and he's playing type of defense, they're running on the treadmill for the next 5 days, no matter what, in this game. But last night, I don't know what that was. And to have two half back-to-back games where the guard, who supposed to be guarded by Stein Clark, Terry Lord Johnson, any type of little guard, so 20-plus points, and dominate, and look like superstars, that's unacceptable, is embarrassing. So to me, you have Nolan Smith, Nolan Smith coached his team the whole season. Get rid of Danny Manning and KT right now. No exceptions. I don't want to hear no excuses. No, they got to go today.
Yeah, hey, appreciate the call, Lawrence. Appreciate you calling in. Now, it's rough, man. It's rough because – and I was making that point, and to Lawrence's point, because there probably will be a change. And I've heard Mark and other people say the economics is going to fire Kenny or have the change take place. The economics are. I mean, just simply because when there's – let's call it. I don't know. I wasn't in the building, but just from the TV view, it looked like a good, 3,500, 3,700. See, you got to think about it like logically, right? Like if there was, let's give them 4,000. Let's give them 4,500. Let's keep going up. Why not? Let's give them 4,500. The Yum Center isn't like you can't cut on half the lights. You know what I mean? You got to cut on all the lights. So it's 4,500 people, but it's lights and concession stands and beers and food for 22,000. All that it's got to be bought because you have to expect 25,000 or 22,000. Expect 10, 15,000. So all the lights still on. All the basketballs are still dribbled. All the PA people are still getting paid. All the TV broadcasts still got to, they got to cash checks. You know what I mean? Like, all of that got to still happen. And only 4,500 people showing up. Well, that's what we call it, operating at a net negative. You know, for the folks in business. For the folks that like money, like to keep chicken. That's called operating at a net negative. When I'm operating as if I expect 15 to 22,000 and there's 4,500 people, that means I'm losing money each and every single game. They announced 10,000 people was there. Well, we know 10,000 people wasn't there. But even if it was 10,000, you're still operating at a net negative of over 50%. That ain't gonna cut it. That is not going to cut it, especially when Nick Coffey's posting pics and videos of just a few short years ago how mighty we were. It was a whiteout against Michigan, and Louisville's the number one team in the country, and they won it with Ryan McMahon hitting threes. Like, that's what the video – Dick Vitale commented on Nick Coffey's video, by the way, and was like, man, that was fun. Man, that place used to be fun. used to be. what is going on? It is so sad. It is sad, guys, because look, and we're going to get to football too, by the way. 8150-939 is the number if you want to get in here. 8150-939 is the number. 3831-939 is the text line. And we're having a great, jolly old time with football, right? But see, if people want to just poo-poo on our party that we have in every single week at LNN Stadium, including on Thursday, they always talk about attendance. Oh, man, there's not no people in the building. It'd be like 50,000 people and folks still crying about attendance. Whatever. They can. That's just people that want to hate. But see, the thing about basketball, see, we never had to worry about that. See, like the reason why they're poo-pooing on attendance, because in basketball, when we're good like this, if we're knocking on the top 10 in the country, oh man, it's been a long time since we've been knocking on the door of top 10 in the country, man. Anyway, but when that is happening, say if the basketball team is number 11 in the country and the basketball team has a chance to win an ACC championship and the basketball team is one of the premier programs in all of the college basketball, see, that place is jam-packed and rocking. See, that's what they're comparing football. See, football is still in its infancy, right? We've had coaches come and go. We haven't had 20-year coaches, you know, 30-year coaches on the football field. And so basketball has. They have a 50-year window where you had two coaches. And so when they are a top 10 team, they sold out. You can't get a ticket. You got the folks outside of Yum Center trying to scalp them things, and nobody's like, hey, man, I'm good. I already got mine, buddy. I'm good. You know what I mean? We good. And we in sync. We wear the white. And, you know, coaches used to come out in their red jackets or their white jackets in their red suits or their white suits. And that's what we used to do on the basketball side of things. And that's why people try to poo-poo on the football. But, man, it's been a long time since that's happened. We got another caller coming in. So what's on your mind? What's happening? You're listening to 35KY Sports Show. What's going on? What's going on, Darren?
Oh, I'm all right. I'm sorry, Jeff. Hey, by the way, you're doing a great job, my friend. I've been a long time caller of the local sports show, but I had to call in. I've been listening to you the last four or five Saturdays, and you are quite the part, my man.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much. What's on your mind?
There's a lot to unpack, man. There's so many things to talk about in such a little time, but I'll be quick as possible. I'll save my point about Kenny Payne last, but, Josh Hurd is, he's not going to have any choice just based on attendance and money alone with Kenny Payne. And the second thing I'll say is, what kind of offense are we running? And yeah. I wouldn't mind seeing Caron Davis, the JC guy, or I really thought before the year started that the Okafor kid, what I saw last year would be a dominant piece to this year's team. But, I mean, I just don't understand the substitution pattern. But, actually, this is a comment and a question to you, and I'll hang up and listen,
okay,
Jeff. And that is, I've been drilling my brain for the last 2 years trying to figure out Kenny Payne and his coaching staff, and I think I figured it out.
Okay, talk to me.
This coaching staff is great. You know, Josh, Nolan, Danny Manning, Kenny Payne, all of them together collectively are great people at telling them what to do in practice and in game, but they sure as heck cannot coach them. That's what I think the problem is. They just cannot coach.
I appreciate you calling in, Darren. Thank you so much. No, I mean, they ain't been able to coach him at will up until so far. I mean, we 35 games in, we got 5 wins. I mean, it is what it is. You don't like the facts, go be mad at somebody else. Don't be mad at me. Go be mad at somebody else. You're 35 games in, and more than that, and you got 5 wins. Who we got next, James? Jeff, what's going on your own with 35KY Sports Show? What's going on?
What's going on, Jeff?
Talk to me.
Love the show, by the way.
Appreciate it.
I just want to say I woke up like everybody else today, heartbroken.
Mm.
I wanted Kenny Payne to work.
Me too.
Not just because, you know, he was alumni here or whatever, just because I wanted something to work. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
I just feel like even after we fire him, we're still going to be at the bottom. It still could take 3 to 4 years of, you know what I'm saying? Who knows how long it's going to take? It's not guaranteed.
We're just
going to find a coach and take off.
That is true.
So that's my whole issue about the situation. And luckily we got football. I'll listen.
Hey, I appreciate it, Jeff, man. Who we got next, James? Okay, gotcha. That's all we got right now. So we do have Coach Kenny Payne talking about the loss to Chattanooga. Let's hear it.
First of all, got to give them credit. That's a very good basketball team that walked in here. They walked in not afraid of us. They walked in and executed their game plan. Thought they were the aggressors. Felt like we were behind the action a lot of the times during the game. And they attacked us. Thought that, you know, they made a bunch of threes and their guard play was energetic and decisive in the way they played. And the big guys also, They played with a tenacity that we didn't match. Or
yeah, I don't need to hear anymore. Because just there's so much there, even in that soundbite. But one thing I'll say, because we do still have to talk about
it. You didn't hear last
football.
Night. It's your first time here.
Yeah, yeah. If that was your first time, I mean, oh my goodness, there's so much. And we still got football to talk about. But I'm going to say this, man. I'm going to say this because, you know, it's easy to compare Kenny to like Rick or Denny Crum. And then, like, that's easy. Like, no, we are not even going to do that because those are Hall of Fame guys. Those are guys that were legends here. That's unfair to him, I'll say. We can just compare him to the last guy that kind of got fired. The last guy that got fired was Chris Mack, right? And we all had certain issues with Chris Mack, but Chris Mack did some things well. I was talking about that time Louisville was number one in the country. That was under Chris Mack. And one thing I could say about Chris Mack is that Chris Mack would have had one guy on this team, say what you want about Chris Mack, that wouldn't have let you lose last night. Like, he would have had one guy on the team. Now, you could say your issues with the pack line. You could say your issues with Mack and the media. And he's kind of awkward a little bit. And he poked the bear at times when he shouldn't have. He didn't beat Kentucky enough. Like, you say all of those things. But Chris Mack would have had a Carleek Jones. Chris Mack would have had a David Johnson, a Jordan Ward. Chris Mack would have had a guy out there that had the ability to make sure you don't lose to Chattanooga. Now, I don't know if you'd have been able to beat Kentucky or Kansas or Duke or whatever. You know, I saw Chris Mack's team melt against Duke. I saw it. But Chris Mack's team's always got up for the little guys. Little guys didn't beat Chris Mack. That's the thing. Little dudes. Chris Mack got them about the paint. It was the big dogs that Chris Mack looked like a little guy against, right? Even if he had a lead. But the little guys he didn't lose to. I saw a stat, and I don't know if it's true or not. I have fact checked, but I'm going to say it because it sounds good. I saw a stat that before 2021, Louisville hadn't lost an exhibition game since like the 70s. I saw that. And they're 3-6 since 2021. Think about that. The 70s. James, you might have been born in the 70s.
That was a stat comes from Kelly Dickey.
Yeah, so Kelly Dickey. Shout out. So I know it's a fact then. They hadn't lost a game in November since the 70s. And now in the last 2 years, they're gone 3-6. That means they lost six games. That's just unacceptable. Like that can't happen. And we understand that can't happen. But, you know, it's what's happening, and that's why, however this ends, I don't know how it'll end. I know it will end, and it's gonna be ugly. We got to take a break, and then we're going to get to some more positive stuff because we're in the catbird seat on this fine college football Saturday. You're listening to the 35KY Sports Show with Jeff Lighty Jr. right here on 93.9 The Ville. Welcome back, everybody, to the 35KY Sports Show. Don't forget, you can text in 3831-939 is the text line. We've got Tony on the line. Tony, what's on your mind? Tony, what's going on?
Jeff, what's going on, my brother?
What's happening, buddy? Nothing much. Trying to make it through.
I hear you. Hey, you're doing a great job. First off, happy Veterans Day to all the veterans out there.
Absolutely.
Let's go Cards. Support the Cards. Support the Bulldog Nation. Hey, last night I watched this game, and I appreciate Kenny so much, and I'm grateful that he's brought us out of this. You know, he was that transition from all the bad news to, hey, we're starting all over, clean slate. You know, let's get our team back in here. Let's bring back a little bit of basketball. And I appreciate that. He's got some talent out there. But I was watching his game, and, man, it was the first time in a long time I was like, this is just not Louisville basketball.
No.
We just lost all of our identity. I can't think of the last time I looked at a game and was like, man, why are we not boxing out? Why are we not closing out on the three-point line? Like, this doesn't even look like Louisville basketball. I can't even tell what I'm watching. Look, man, I support it all. Grateful for Kenny, grateful for the coaching staff that we have. We've been spoiled with nothing but great and excellent coaches. And I think, you know, Kenny just happened to get, you know, the Cards, and it didn't work out for him. But, you know, still here, still a fan, still supporting. Jeff, you're doing a great job. Happy Veterans Day again for everyone. Thanks for having me on the line.
Appreciate you, Tony. Appreciate you calling in. Don't forget 3831-939 is the text line. I see you guys texting about the substitution packages. Someone texted in and says, U of L loses $500,000 per game when they have below 9,000 fans. I don't know if that's, you know, somebody can fact check that, but that is what someone texted in, and that's pretty rough. And someone also texted in, Jeff's going to win more games in his first year than Kenny's entire career. I hope that's not the case, but it just very well may be the case. And speaking of Jeff, we're talking about Jeff Brohm this Thursday, this past Thursday. Ooh, they gave us a scare, didn't they? We almost saw our Orange Bowl dreams go down the drain. We almost saw our chances. You know, some of y'all are thinking about playoffs, and so I'm just thinking about our chances to make it to Charlotte, our ACC championship appearance go down the drain. But nevertheless, some people said never a doubt, and some people, I'm talking about the Bring Brohm home guy. He put 10,000 on the fact that Louisville would win. Now, I ain't 10,000 to win $800. I ain't that bold. But the Bring Home Brohm guy, I got to shout you out, because he said never a doubt, and he put his money where his mouth is. He's not a punk like me. I'm a punk when it comes to that stuff. 10 bands for an $800 return. And did Isaac Garrido, Amari Huggins, Bruce, and heck, even Jack Plummer come through for you to win that game 31-24 over Virginia? Now, let me put this out there. Virginia, the quarterback, Mr. Cordova, he's a player. That young man can play. He looked like mini Johnny Manziel out there against Louisville. But at the end of the day, when the Cardinals needed a stop and needed a score, they got both in critical moments, including a 52-yard touchdown pass from Plummer to Amari Huggins-Bruce and a 73-yard touchdown run from Isaac Garrido to bring home the victory and to improve the Cardinals to 9-1 on the year. Good news just keeps flowing, because this morning I saw Miss Kelly Green, mother of Quincy Riley, posted Quincy got an invitation to the East-West Shrine game. It's one of the premier all-star games for NFL draft prospects. So all things are flowing, and he won't be the last. I'm sure multiple guys will get all-star invites. The NFL came out and said that juniors now will be allowed to be invited to the Senior Bowl and to different all-star events. So expect Ashton Gelati, who is a junior, to get some invites, because we're losing those guys to the league. You know, when you have NFL guys on your team, you tend to lose them to the NFL. And that is a good thing to have, especially when you're 9-1 and in the catbird seat. So you're watching this Saturday, because multiple teams ahead of you, you're 9-1, you're number 11 in the country, and multiple teams ahead of you will have to lose today due to the games that are being played this week. And so it's a beautiful time on the gridiron. It's a beautiful time, because this time next week, you will be a top 10 team in the country. This time next week, you will be playing for a chance to clinch that second spot in the ACC championship game. This time next week, everything will be on the line for you to line up and possibly have a chance of playing in the Orange Bowl, have a chance to play Florida State for maybe a spot in the college football playoff. And you couldn't ask for more in year one of the Jeff Brohm experience. This has been a delicacy, because I said preseason that I thought we'd win 10 games. We're at 9 games with Miami, Kentucky, potentially an ACC championship game, and potentially a bowl game, all left on the table. And I said 10 wins. You could be looking at 12 wins. 13 wins if you win all four. Now, I'm not getting ahead of myself, but I said 10 wins. I felt good about this program. The problem is preseason. The problem was I didn't know what we had in Jack Plummer, and I didn't know what we had in that defense. Well, we can say right here, the defense didn't have their best game outing on Thursday, but they got stops when they needed it. And Jack Plummer, for sure, didn't have his best game on Thursday. But he made plays when we needed them the most. And that's all you can ask for. That's the sign of a resilient team. That's the sign of a team that is playing for their coach. That is a sign of a team that is well coached on both sides of the ball. You got a special teams touchdown. You got stops on defense when you needed them the most, including an interception. You made plays on all three phases of football. That is even when you made mistakes. You made mistakes on defense. Virginia outgained you on the road. They were on the road. They came into your house on a theme night. And you can leave your glow theme comments to someone else. I know a lot of y'all wasn't happy about that. But nonetheless, it was a theme night. You had specialty jerseys. It was Thursday night, night game. And Virginia came to play. Tony Elliott had those young men ready to come in here and beat Louisville. And they played like they were going to beat Louisville. It's just Louisville decided, you know, I was just talking about on basketball, there was a couple of guys that would take over when you play little guys and say, hey, we're not losing this game. Like, nah, come on, y'all. We're not losing this game. Well, those guys, one of those guys, whether you believe it or not, was Jack Plummer. He made it happen. We've got someone else on the line, Nasir. What's going on? You're on with 93.9.
What's up?
What's happening with you, man?
Man, look. So I'm gonna keep it pretty short and simple. As far as the football goes, man, you know, the team, that's just a great all around team. They never fold under the pressure. You know, I know the Pittsburgh game was what it was, but in every other situation during the season when we had close to a full strength team, they never fold under the pressure, and that's why they deserve to go to the ACC championship, which they probably will.
Absolutely.
As far as basketball is concerned, it's over with. And we just need to just wrap it up as far as this coaching staff goes, because I went to both of the first two games.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I've been telling everybody I'm going to just get rid of that Wesleyan loss, and I'm going to just be positive until we lose a real game. We lost a real game. Now I'm done. It's over.
Mm. I appreciate you calling us here, man. Appreciate you. Yeah. I just want to throw this out here. We only got a few more minutes left. I just want to throw this out here. We all, I think, as a fan base, right? I think it's safe to say we've come to the consensus that this is probably the end of this experiment when it comes to our former player and a legend in our game, a national champion, a first-round pick, Kenny Payne, as the head coach. Would you guys want to see what Nolan Smith could do? Because I think I do. I think I would want to see what Nolan Smith could be as an interim head coach of this team. Because Nolan Smith is still a hot commodity. Whether you guys like Nolan or not, Nolan Smith is still a hot name out here on these coaching streets. He didn't get that interview, whether you believe he would have took it or not, that's on you. But he didn't get that interview for that G League team for no reason. I think we know what Danny Manning is. I don't really care to know what Jameson is. I'm good on that. And just, you know, it is what it is. But I would like to see how this Louisville team would look under the guidance and direction of Nolan Smith. I would like to see how this Louisville program could recruit under the guidance and direction of a Nolan Smith. I would like to see those things. Because Nolan Smith's name still holds a lot of weight in recruiting circuits, on the recruiting trail, outside the city of Louisville. Like, his name holds weight. Like, he helped Duke. Like, Duke is Duke. But a lot of those guys during his time at Duke came because Nolan Smith was the coach. Nolan's name held weight with Trenton Flowers. He said it. Trenton said it. In my interview, go watch it. He said, you know, I called Nolan first. You know, it's what he said. You know, it is what it is. So I would like to see what a Nolan Smith could do as the head of a program. Now, some of you say, oh, it's the same thing. I get it. I'm not saying, like, you have to hire him full time. But just see what this team could do. See what the recruiting would be like. I mean, first-year guys, I talk about, like, if some of you say, this job is too big for first-year head coaches. Kinda. It's kinda true. But I saw Duke hire a first-year head coach. That seems to be working out pretty well. John Shire. I saw North Carolina hire a first-time head coach. That seems to be doing okay. That was Hubert Davis. He came out the broadcast booth. You know what I mean? So, like, now, granted, they were assistants at those schools. I get it. They were assistants at those schools for a year. But nonetheless, they were first-year head coaches, and they seem to be having some success. I also saw a couple of first-year head coaches at other places that have had great success in year one. So the Nolan Smith thing, I'm just throwing it out there. Just tell me what you think. I don't know. But that's all we have. James is playing my wrap-up music, so that means it's time to go. Thank you guys, as always, for listening to the 35KY Sports Show. I am your host, Jeff Lightsey Jr. To our producers, James Black, Jeff Houston, and Murph, thank you to Coach Ivan Green for stepping in, and we will see you guys next time. Peace.